नमस्कार आईच्या हेडोनात तुमकां सगळ्यांक येवकार. आनी आज आमचे बरोबर अशे एक स्पेशल गेस्ट आसात जांचे बरोबर आमी खुबश्यो गजाली उलोवपाक शकतात. राजकारणाचेर उलोवपाक शकतात, मिडियाचेर उलोवपाक शकतात. ही इज नॉट अवर युज्युअल पॉलिटिकल गेस्ट, बट समबडी हू कॅन गीव यू अ व्हेरी न्युएन्स्ड व्ह्यू ऑफ प्रेझंट पॉलिटिक्स, सोसायटी अँड मिडिया. वी हॅव विथ अस इन द स्टुडिओ वेतरन जर्नलिस्ट अँड फाउंडर ऑफ एडिटरजी विक्रमचंद्र. विक्रमजी वेलकम. अँड लेट मी स्टार्ट विथ अ व्हेरी व्हेरी सिम्पल क्वेश्चन, बिकॉज दिस इज अ टेलिव्हिजन शो अँड आय बिलीव यू आर कमिंग बॅक ऑन टेलिव्हिजन शो आफ्टर हाऊ मेनी इयर्स.
आय डोंट थिंक आय हॅव बीन इन अ टेलिव्हिजन स्टुडिओ नाव फॉर वॉट, 4 years नाव, मे बी 5 years इट्स बीन. अँड इट्स ऑल्सो व्हेरी गुड टू बी सिटिंग ऑन दिस साईड इन्स्टेड ऑफ दॅट साईड. Answer questions.
And the question is why? Why this sannyas from political studio? Is it a state of mind or state of media?
I think it's a state of media more than the state of mind. It's also the part of the evolution, right? Hmm. My view is technologies change, things change. There was a time when media was print. Then there was a time when media was broadcast journalism, and that is when I started my career. Then it became digital, and that was an exciting journey also when digital was starting to come. Yeah. But 5 years ago, 6 years ago, I felt ki bhai sab kuch change hone wala hai.
Yeah.
The existing nature of the media is going to change. Linear television is going to die. Television news in its present format is going to phase out. Something new is going to come. What will that something new be? Instead of watching it from afar, why not work in trying to build it up? Hmm. And that's essentially what I've been trying to do for the last 4 years with Editorgy.
Two factors. Number one, that realization that things are changing. Number two, the realization that this is not where I belong. What was it? Both?
See, the television has changed. It's not, I don't think it was a lack of belonging as much as wanting to shape the next thing. You know, we are lucky. In our lifetimes, we are seeing multiple waves that are coming. Hmm. So when I started off, everything in India used to be print, broadcast journalism, nobody had heard. When I said, mujhe broadcast journalist banna hai, people say, broadcast journalism toh hai nahi India mein, kya broadcast journalism banoge, kuch hota hi nahi hai, Doordarshan hai, that was it. We did video cassettes, news yeah. track. News track ke video cassettes, VCR pe log dekhte the, and then from there then television started. So it was a new way of doing things, right? Yeah. And it's exciting when something does not exist and you try and create it. It's very exciting. I felt the same excitement in early 2000s when we said bhai news agar aana hai mobile phone pe news dalna hai, video on the internet, can it be done? It was a very exciting process of building it up. Now this particular journey started when I was interviewing, actually like this, I was interviewing Sundar Pichai of Google.
Yeah.
And he said ki real disruption is going to come now when people in individual industries will figure out, I said there's no AI revolution taking place. He said AI revolution will come, and AI revolution will come when people in individual industries who understand that industry will use AI to disrupt their own industries.
Oh.
They will use AI to disrupt their own business. Hmm. When they do that, that's when disruption and change will come. I said, bhai, interesting, hey, sounds like good gyan.
Yeah.
How does it actually work? And then I said, how are people using AI to disrupt the media business? And there are very few good case studies or successful examples of that, not just in India, but anywhere in the world.
Hmm.
I said, okay, how should it be done if you have to do it? So I went and sat in my basement for 2 years. And said, okay, this is where I think, this is how I think it can be done. Now, are we the only people who will succeed in doing it? Perhaps not. Are we the right people who will be able to do it? Maybe not. But it's a very exciting challenge to try and see what is the technology of the future. How will video news be consumed in 2025 and in 2030?
But if you look at the state of media right now and the way video news is consumed, how do you compare with, I know it's a very obvious question, but I'm tempted to ask because you're sitting there. How do you compare it with probably that cassette era vis-a-vis this explosion of satellite televisions? Are we better off or are we worse off?
I have no hesitation in saying we're worse off.
Mm.
That's a very simple question to answer. Cassette era for a reporter was great fun. We used to get 1.5 months, 2 months, maybe we used to get a chance to go out and do a story. Unlimited, unbelievable. Great time, go out, you do a reporter, you do a story. Tele- television news is also at one time used to be about news.
Yeah.
It used to be go get the news and give the news to the people. And be. I was trained in an era of journalism where you said you should try and, whatever, you may have a strong opinion, but keep it to yourself. Mm. Unless it is something like, you know, somebody beating up a child or rape or all that, you are justified in having an opinion. But I've always been trained that you are supposed to be reporting the news. You're not supposed to become the news yourself. Now, that's not obviously the way news functions anymore for most part. Now, it's that the anchor person thinks that that anchor person is all important, is God, and therefore their opinion really is what matters. There's nothing wrong with that, I guess, but it's not what I personally believe in.
Why do you think that has happened? And and from when do you think that started happening?
Okay, that question is a question which I have thought about a lot.
Hmm.
And let me be honest that it has a lot to do with the business model of the way television news played itself out. And bear with me for a couple of minutes while I take you through it. Because what happened to television news in India? Now, there are suddenly 20, 30 channels have come up. TK, 40 channels, 100 channels, then 200 channels came up. In India, unlike in many countries abroad, television news channels don't get subscription money. I know you must be facing it also. Subscription money, you do not get any subscription money.
Yes.
You are entirely dependent on, in fact, you are paying carriage fees to cable operators.
Absolutely.
Right. So your entire revenue model comes from advertising. Advertising comes from TRPs.
Hmm.
Now, if you are lucky enough to be you and you are in a place like Goa where you have a monopoly, advertising will still come to you, so you are well off. But in the most of the world, for most of the news channels, you have a situation where you've got to compete for those TRPs. Hmm. TRPs in India come from 50,000 boxes in a country of 1.4 billion people. Those TRPs, it is can be scientifically shown, you will only get TRPs if you're being tabloid, if you're being sensational, if you're shouting, if you're getting other people to shout. You know, that is where the TRPs come from. It doesn't necessarily come
from... Is it the media shaping the society or society shaping the media?
I think it's a bit of both. It's just the what's the way the business model is. And I spent a lot of time when I used to be in television news arguing about it, railing against the system, complaining about it, saying, kya hai? Certainly something like television news, according to me, but I was an idealist, I'm still an idealist. I believe television news is a calling. It's something which is a service you're providing to society. You should not be doing a service to society like providing news and information only on the basis of TRPs. If you do this, the TRP will increase. If you do this, the TRP will decrease. So let's make it as much mirch masala as we can, because you'll get TRPs. If it means creating trouble where no trouble exists, doesn't matter, we'll get TRPs. Make two people shout at each other, TRPs, right? That's what is happening. It's just something which I'm fundamentally uncomfortable with.
But again, two aspects to it. Number one is making those things for TRPs, and what's happening now? What's happening now is the anchors have become the spokespersons. They have become spokespersons probably of political parties, or they have become spokespersons probably of political ideologies. That is a very, very big shift from what we are talking. We have seen the era of Bhoot, Preet, Pishach, everything on television.
Yeah.
That was for TRPs. Now that was like we as journalists feeling uncomfortable about it, but yet having at the back of our mind that okay, we are doing this for numbers, we are doing this for business. And then comes a phase where those walls are broken, completely broken, and everybody is out there giving very strong opinions and taking positions. Now, if you are a media house, you should be either on this side of the aisle or that side of the political ideology. Why do you think we have reached there from just doing that for TRPs to probably at the cost of TRPs also taking political positions?
It is entirely because it's not just in India, by the way. Even if you look at abroad, if you look at America, people who are taking a strong position, somebody says, I love Trump or I hate Trump, they will get more ratings than somebody who says, okay, we are going to try and give you just the simple facts. The same is happening in India also. If you're taking politically loaded opinions, one side or the other side, that is where the TRPs come from. So you can say, I love the government, or you can say, I hate the government, right? And there are TRPs in both of them, potentially.
Yes.
it is when you are saying, I'm going to try and be factual, I'm trying to try and warp the, tell you, wait, this is what the government is doing, this is correct, this thing can be changed, I will criticize this, I will praise this. When you're trying to be factual and middle of the road, what I think is journalistically more correct,
yeah,
that is not where you're getting TRP. So now, if you are saying, I will do what is journalistically the correct thing to do, journalistically the correct thing to do, it means you're reconciling yourself that the TRPs nahi aayenge, uska matlab hai revenue nahi aayegi, uska matlab hai the company will start making losses. So it is a, it is an issue, right? Now there are some people are able to, there are people who are now starting to find ways of navigating it and of being able to do it correctly and still make money and make profits, which is a good thing to see. I'm very happy to see it. Mm-hmm. It's especially, I think, happening in some of the organizations like yours, which are more centered in a particular area where you've got a certain amount of control, it's better. But this is leading, in my view, to very dangerous implications for society, for the country. And it's not just in India, again, as I'm saying.
Yeah.
It's happening around the world. I'll talk about digital in a while. The algorithms that I believed would help in fixing things, in many ways, are making things worse.
Yeah.
Because it's again locking you into...
Yeah, we felt that social media would democratize everything. It has become anti-social media. No?
Yes. And that was a big... When I left television, I said, okay, I'm going to do entirely digital. So somebody said, achata, are you saying that digital is the answer to what is going wrong in television? Unfortunately, not. In fact, in many ways, digital is even worse.
Even worse.
Even worse. And that's because what is happening? You have algorithms that are deciding that, okay, show him X, Y, Z, show her something else.
Hmm.
Why am I showing this to you? Because I think you're going to, the algorithms are telling me you will click on it.
Hmm.
So therefore, how do I make sure you click on it? If it is something that that you will agree with, that makes you happy watching this, that you sympathize with, if it's a view that you are, that will be fundamentally in agreement with your beliefs in the world, you're more likely to click on it. Which means the algorithm will show you content that feeds your own views, that feeds your prejudices, that feeds your opinion on various things in life. What is that doing is, it is increasing the divisions, it's increasing the schisms to the point now where two sides don't even agree on what the facts are. As I said, look at the United States. In the United States, 2 years later, there's still not an agreement in the United States that who won the election. Was there an election? Was it a free and fair election? Did somebody win the election? So who won the election? Depending on whom you ask, you will have completely different radical views on it, because people are no longer being able to agree on what is reality.
Was a society equally radical 20 years back and it was not getting manifested because of lack of communication modules like the social media, or we have become more radical now?
I think maybe there was certain radical, or everyone has always had strong opinions, especially in a country like India. Everyone's always had them. There were certain things that you would not express in polite society because it was not considered, there were certain prejudices and all
acceptable.
That you did not, it was not acceptable. It wasn't acceptable to say those things even in a small group or in front of it with friends. You didn't vent certain, you know, certain views. But now when you see them every evening on television news, their views I expressed that would be considered hate speech 10 years ago. I expressed regularly.
On live television every evening.
On live television. So then, therefore, it is not anymore considered
unacceptable.
That unacceptable to be saying that in society also. And this is, I think, a real problem. So to my mind, those cleavages and those divisions of society are being exacerbated. They are being widened. And that is a trend that I think and I fear is going to continue. And the algorithms...
only going to make it worse.
Yes, the algorithms are feeding into it. Because you and I may not, if you are sitting on a particular view on a subject, and I'm sitting on the other view of a subject, the algorithms will make sure that everything I'm seeing is confirming my biases.
Yeah.
Everything that you're seeing is confirming your biases. You and I will not agree with each other. We're not talking the same language anymore. We're not in the same sphere anymore. And that's scary.
So you agree that the social media is no longer social?
I think it is not just the question of social media. Social media is also fanning it. But in the digital world, we've got to try and make sure, and it's an important point, because when we were developing some of the algorithms and other things around Editurgy, I was very concerned about the, it was very easy for us to build an algorithm that would create a news channel that is perfect for you, right? Which is fundamentally what we did. We said we are creating pieces of information and we'll get an algorithm to stitch it together, right? So that it is a good newscast for you. And it was very easy for us to build that algorithm which would give you exactly what you want. We said, hey, the badi achhi news, that is exactly what I want. Everything is, I agree with everything on this. But I felt there was something fundamentally, you use the word antisocial, I felt it was something wrong with that. Because then you're not being exposed to anything different. You're not being exposed to contrary views.
And the basic idea behind news and media is to expose you to different views and viewpoints and facts.
And not just views and viewpoints. Actually, we don't even have too many views. We are saying first just be informed.
Informed, yeah.
Because the biggest problem today is not that people are not getting views. They're getting views from everywhere. But how do you get those 20, 30 stories that you need to be informed person? Now, you are in a media organization. You're informed, you're seeing what is happening, you're making up your mind. But if you look at the vast majority of the world, and I go out and I meet people, the number of people I meet who say, we don't watch television news anymore. And we haven't watched TV news for years. I have people coming up to me and say, we saw you yesterday on television news. I said, how could you have? I haven't been on TV news for 4 years. They said, actually, you're right. We haven't also watched for 4 or 5 years. You know, they just don't watch TV news. Okay, you're not watching TV news. Many people say you're not watching, reading the print newspapers. How are you being informed? They say, oh, somebody sends us stories on WhatsApp and now I'm informed. Or I pick up the stories, I'll see it on Facebook. And that's not comprehensive information. It's, to use a food analogy, it's not a balanced diet. You're picking up little pieces of information. Many of them are coming from your friends and family. Some of them could be coming from people whose political views agree with yours, or your views on society.
Or who want to influence your views.
Or want to influence your views. So that is what you're getting it on. You're not getting 20, 30 stories which are
which purely inform you.
Absolutely. So that is what is missing today in society.
Is it a reflection of the political system, prevailing political system in the country also?
I'm not entirely sure about that. I mean, look, I think there are issues which is happening with the system and politics and the way, you know, the law is being interpreted, especially when it comes to journalists, which are making it tougher to get all viewpoints across. But I don't think that's responsible for this. I think this is a trend that has started to happen. And it's a trend, as I'm again saying, if it was only a trend in India, I'd say yes. When I look at the United States, the same trends that we are seeing are playing themselves out there. And I've sometimes used this analogy, which I still think I believe in to a large extent. Why is this dangerous? Because, you know, the era of mass media for the last 50, 60, 70 years, it's been one of the most peaceful eras on the planet. Not that much. It seems unpeaceful, a lot of fighting, but it's not anything compared to what has traditionally happened.
Stable.
It's been relatively stable. And that's because there has been mass media, in my view. News has been telling you, but ye ho raha hai, the different points of view. So there's been a sort of a consensus and you've been relatively well informed. What's happening now with social media and with channels also which are propagating one particular point of view is you're getting, everyone is getting locked back into the tribal system. I'm this tribe. I'm that tribe. I believe in this. I believe in this. I believe in this. I don't agree with each other. We don't agree to even have a conversation with each other. We hate each other. I'm BJP. I'm Aam Aadmi Party. I'm Congress. I'm something else. We don't speak the same language. We don't agree with anything anymore. I actually think the other person is like a demon, right? And the US, same. You know, Democrats and Republicans will feel that you are the other person's a devil, right? If you take a subject like abortion, nobody will agree. Rifle, nobody will agree. So things out here similarly. This is becoming more and more. You're coming back to a very tribal society. And a society where you're listening to your local village priest as opposed to having a wider view. And we know what that has led to in the past.
You mentioned all the political parties. Now, looking at 2024, on the backdrop of what we have been discussing, do you think, two questions, number one, do you think the BJP as an election machine is practically invincible now. Number two, the present state of Congress is only fueling that invincibility.
So with the rider that I haven't been spending as much time looking closely at politics, I've been looking more at technology for the last 2 years. So I've not been out there talking to political circles and all the way I once would have done it. So I'm no particular expert in this anymore, looking at it very closely. But
I want to know your instincts on this.
My instincts on it are simply saying that I think the BJP is in a very, very dominant position right now. And I think the dominance is being fed by the fact that there's no effective opposition right now. And yes, you're right that the Congress has vacated a large geographical part of the country where it was only the Congress that could take on the BJP, whether it is, you know, looking all the way up the western coast, was a place where only the Congress was fighting with the BJP. There's a far tougher challenge that comes to the BJP from various regional parties, whether it's in Tamil Nadu or West Bengal or Odisha or Telangana, or, you know, you name it.
Yeah.
The regional parties are putting up a fairly big fight. So, as of this moment in 2022, the BJP looks in a very, very strong position. They are at least in the fight, and the Congress is right now showing more signs of fighting within itself. And the opposition parties seem right now more interested in saying who is the challenger, rather than actually defeating the BJP.
Yeah.
Having said that, 2 years is a long time in politics, so you don't entirely know what will happen. And it is possible that if the opposition gets into this federal front sort of a situation, where instead of saying there's one, if there's one person who pops up and says, I'm going to be the challenger to Narendra Modi, very tough. Narendra Modi is a very, very dominant, powerful politician, and I don't think one, it's very easy for any individual person to come up and challenge him for a long, long time. But maybe
you don't see any regional political setup from the opposition space emerging as a national alternative the way some of them are at least trying to project or trying.
As I said, it depends on if any of them think that they will become the challenger individually to Narendra Modi. I would be very surprised if that was to actually succeed. So if you have a Kejriwal or a Nitish Kumar or a Mamata Banerjee or certainly or Rahul Gandhi saying that I am going to become the challenger to Narendra Modi, I think they're going to struggle because I don't think they will be able to dislodge him. But what you have said, that an alliance of opposition parties, is that more like, that's at least what you keep hearing. I've heard Trinamool Congress and Nitish and others, KCR, all talking about we must come together. We must come together as an alliance of state parties fighting the BJP. That would, at least my instinct would be to say that has more chance of succeeding than one person trying to take
it. Whereas Prashant Kishore in one of his interactions very candidly said that merely by bringing everybody together, it may see as an arithmetic force, but there might not be the chemistry that is required to take on a behemoth that BJP's election machinery has become today. Do you agree with that even if there is an alliance that poses challenge to the existing BJP setup, there needs to be some chemistry there?
Yes, but I mean, I saw that same interview which Prashant Kishore had done, and if you see where he went on to talk about it further, he was really talking about the same sort of a thing. There are 150 seats where the BJP has no chance. You've got to figure out what has to happen elsewhere. So, but I mean, look, fundamentally, is the opposition going to be able to get its act together by 2024? I don't know. Your guess is as good as mine. You know, when you look at the state of, when you look at what is happening in the Congress party right now, where they're not even being able to agree on who the going to be the president of the party, there seems to be this never-ending saying that, okay, somehow persuade Rahul Gandhi to stand. I'm not quite sure where that is headed. I mean, I think one of the, coming back to my television days, I think one of the clips that I had done on a big fight, which is probably, it goes viral every single year, and it's been going viral every single year since 2015, it's now 7 years, is that Gardner Harris clip of, you know, where he said that Rahul Gandhi is not, you know, we keep on saying Rahul Gandhi, grow into your role, but he can't do it. You know, that seems to be a never-ending question for the Congress.
Do you think Rahul Gandhi is right now the biggest ally of Narendra Modi?
I know many people in the BJP think that. I'm sure that Narendra Modi himself thinks that. But whether it is or isn't, look, these are questions, I guess, it's there for the Congress party to figure itself, to figure out.
Looking at 2024 again, do you think the kind of machinery that BJP has built, an election machinery that BJP has built, why do you think it has become so massively successful? What's the combination that makes it so massively successful? Only organizational structure on ground or something more than that?
I think it's a combination of many factors that have made the BJP very successful. I mean, I think, look, let's not discount the fact that in Narendra Modi, they do have a very, very popular and a very powerful leader. And sometimes in times of trouble, the country does swing behind a leader, right? And that is something which the opposition just doesn't have. Now, when you add that, you've got a very powerful leader and that face which nobody in the opposition can take on. When you add to that the election machine, when you add to that a hunger to win that many people do not have, and then of course the opposition will say, then add to the other things, add the electoral bonds, add the fact that the institutions are helping the BJP. I heard Rahul Gandhi saying that if I had the ED and the CBI and the XYZ supporting me, then even I'd be able to win elections. You know, okay, all of that is fair enough. But there are multiple factors that are actually playing themselves out. And that, I think, is why the BJP becomes so formidable. And then there are other things which then become, you know, things that which don't obviously strike you. In 2019, for example, which is the last time I think I really spent a lot of time on the ground looking at politics. Subsequently, as I said, I've been focusing a lot more on technology and how do you get AI to function than that. But when I was on the ground there, a lot of people were talking about things like something as simple as toilets. And in retrospect, after the results came out, I used to tell myself I should have thought more about it. I mean, I loved the Swachh Bharat mission. Even in my television avatar, I'd done many campaigns around Swachh Bharat and saying this is a major thing. And I'm so glad that, you know, you're having it right from the Prime Minister and others are talking about Swachh Bharat. But the fact that something like that can pay electoral dividends should have struck a lot of us a lot more than it did, because actually, when I was roaming around in the interiors of Haryana or Uttar Pradesh or Madhya Pradesh or Maharashtra and everywhere, when you would go to the villages and you talk to, you know, women out there and saying, what do you think? They said, they'd always come up and say, achhi baat hai, hamare paas ab ek shauchale hai, bathroom. Something as simple as that. It sounds simple.
But it has a huge impact on the ground.
It has a huge impact on the ground. Right? Now, in 2024, when I'm looking at something as like the Jal Jeevan mission, which I've done some work with that with Eritergy, I'm not sure what sort of an impact something like that is going to have. You shouldn't discount that.
Yeah.
Because if suddenly you're getting water out of taps, which you didn't get earlier, is that going to influence your
voting
decision?
So it's much more than the ideological rhetoric and the election machinery. It's an actual impact that's happening on the ground.
Precisely.
That many high-flying journalists also discounted in 2019.
They discount. Yeah, exactly the point. So I'm saying that at the end of the day, when you think, oh, it's going to be the caste arithmetic and it's going to be this and I feel this is happening,
the impact is much more deeper.
When you're talking to people on the ground and you're asking them, it's not, they weren't necessarily talking about polarization
or ideologies or
ideology or Hindu Muslim.
They're talking about what difference it made in their life.
Precisely. So they were talking about something as simple as toilets.
Yeah.
And in retrospect, I looked back at it and said, it should have struck me.
Yeah. On that note, Vikramji, I'm completely out of time. We can keep on going because this is a very interesting subject, but completely out of time. It is an absolute pleasure talking to you. Thanks a lot for accepting our invitation and coming to our studio.
Look, Goa is my second home now.
So we should keep doing this.
I'm happy to keep coming.
We should keep doing this. Thanks. Pleasure talking to you.
Lovely.
तुम्ही पळतात प्रुडंट यू आर वॉचिंग प्रुडंट.
The
all-new Prudent app is here. Watch news videos and bulletins on the go. Catch up with all your favorite programs. Never miss a breaking news with Prudent notification.